Praise Yah, praise Yah, saints of the Most High, my family, welcome, welcome, welcome. Another Blog Talk, Straitway Truth. This is Brother Shane here tonight. Bless you all. Shalom, shalom, shalom. Hopefully I'm getting a good signal. I was having a pretty unique time logging on in here tonight. Computer giving me a little bit of problems here. I've got to work on this thing and hopefully get this thing ironed out. It's not running as well as it should be. But bless you all. We'll go on here. I hopefully can get a mic check to make sure that I'm coming over quite well before I enter into this continuation. Coming in well. Coming in clear. Hallelujah. Brother Paul, you having trouble too, huh? Whew, I don't know what's going on with this thing. I thought I was the only one. Yeah, it's still going. It's going in and out. All right. Sorry about that, Sister Rose. I don't know what's going on with this Blog Talk. It just don't work like it should. Hopefully it'll clear up here. Well, bless you all. I bless you. Pray that you all had a blessed Sabbath. Enjoy the word, especially about healing. Healing is the children's bread, and especially us as ministers of the Most High Yah. Oh, Brother Steve, it took him a while to log in. Yeah. So this thing is, Blog Talk issues. I know it. I had trouble. I had everything lined up. Had the studio activated and everything. Next thing I know, it unactivated. Then it activated again. Then the chat room wouldn't load because it said something about some kind of flash problem. And I dropped off of it. And then I clicked back on it again. It said the same thing. And I clicked off and clicked back on it. Then the chat room loaded. I'm going, what in the world is wrong with this thing? But the devil's a lie. We rebuke him in the name of Jesus. As he's always wanting to prevent the word. But he can't go beyond his boundaries because he's a created being. He's got to stay himself within the frame of Yah because he himself was framed with the word of Yah. So he's pretty much on a leash, on a tether as well. He thinks he's doing this stuff under his own volition. He wants to be like the Most High. Now his time is short. His time is growing very short. And he knows it. Boggs Croc Radio, yeah, time to do a call. I tried to call BTR one time. I called their manager. He never did call back. We were having quite a bit of times before. And that was not good. And that shows their reputation as a service. They're not reputable as, you know, they should be. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, I thought tonight I would continue and pick up, you know, last time I did scripture study, did it on members and lust. Never did get finished with it. I thought I'd continue tonight with it, you know, and bring it on home, hopefully, as the Holy Spirit will lead. That's about all I can do is let the Holy Spirit lead, you know, because without Jesus, we can do nothing. It's not good to, you know, I don't really like to prepare myself too heavily, you know, for speaking something or have it, you know, in such an order to where, you know, the Holy Spirit does not have room to minister. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Looks like 7 users tonight. Usually have more people in the room by now. But I guess we'll just go on. If you have your Bibles, which I know you do, let us turn to Romans chapter 7. We'll kind of go over a little bit what we talked about last time, scripture study. And hopefully pick up where we left off. And Brother Paul or Brother Steve, if you feel like it, you can go ahead and post scriptures for me. That would be a blessing. Hallelujah. Bless Sister Angela. Praise Yah. But we're starting at Romans chapter 7. I'm going to start at verse 14. Talking about members, talking about lust, talking about things that are warring in our members, the body of sin. You know, that's something that a lot of believers, you know, need to start understanding themselves, especially as believers, true believers. That, you know, we, the true believers, we can actually see physically, and we actually can see spiritually. We have a physical body, and we have a spiritual body. And we need to understand, you know, especially in the days coming ahead, you know, how to discern between the two. We got to know ourselves for what we are, what we are composed of. We are fearfully and wonderfully made, and we're made after the image of Yah. And spiritually, he's bringing us back into the image where it was lost in the beginning when Adam transgressed. He pretty much spiritually died to the Most High Yah. And now here we are, you know, under the second man, Adam, who come and became a quickening spirit, who was a quickening spirit. Now he lives in us. Now we can partake of the second Adam. Hallelujah. 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 All right. It came back. Praise Yah. I don't know what's going on with this blog talk, but starting at Romans 7:14 says, "For we know," and I wonder who that "we" is. Let's take time, understand that we are the "we," and what the epistle is talking to us is to us, the saints, is the Israelites, the Hebrew Israelites. "For we know that the law is spiritual." Do we actually know that the law is spiritual? Because you remember when Pastor, you know, was talking about when the reading of the law was taking place, the commandments, you know, what does it mean to us? You know, as they're being read, do we actually listen and meditate and soak ourselves in the very law that is actually keeping us, the very law that keeps us in peace with Yah, keeps us in His grace with Yah, that, you know, here we are in His kingdom. And He does have, you know, laws, precepts, statutes for us. If we would desire to, you know, abide in this kingdom, as He has bought us and put us in the kingdom, and we have a desire, we have a delight to do His law. Because many of us have the testimony, we have received the gift of the Holy Ghost. We have the Spirit on the inside, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And when we received that baptism, there was a law written in our hearts and written in our minds. And because it's written there in our hearts and our minds, it's there continually to keep us in good standing with the Most High Yah. It's never been against us. It's never grievous for us unless, you know, we partake of all that is in the world. And then all that is in the world is going to, yeah, make the commandments of Yah grievous. But it says, "For we know that the law is spiritual." Let us get to understanding that very law of obedience, that law that's going to be our patience in the end time. I was talking to a brother today. I said, you know, a lot of this spiritual warfare that we got going on in our mind is always there to get us out of obedience to the law. And in doing that, the spirits, they do everything they can to get our eyes off the Most High Yah and get it on ourselves and start pitying ourselves and looking at ourselves and loathing ourselves, and, you know, in manners we ain't supposed to. And, you know, that's the warfare that we are in. We live in the flesh. We also live in the spirit. And the believers really got to come to this understanding about these two realms. And that's what Paul here in Romans 7 is trying to get the believers to understand about this war, to separate one body from another. Because we know flesh and blood shall not inherit the kingdom of Yah. So we know with this flesh, the outer man, and pretty much everything about it's going back to where it come from. It come from the dust of the ground. "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I," and he's talking about this, "I am carnal, sold under sin." So we got a spiritual law, but you got Paul here saying that, yeah, I know myself, my being, you know, my my physical self, my fleshly self, is carnal, sold under sin. And he starts going into an understanding of that. He goes into an explanation of that. He, in verse 15, he says, "For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not, but what I hate, that I do." You know, he finds something in him. There's always, you know, as in the life of the believer, as Paul's talking here. You know, in everything he wants to do good, he wants to do righteous, he wants to do justly. When he's, you know, getting ready to perform that, he sees the opposite there at the same time present with him. So a lot of the times, you know, through his carnality, his heart, you know, his inner being is purposed to do one thing, but he sees himself doing another. So that's what he's trying to make the correlation here, trying to make the division here. As he's trying to use the word of Yah to be a discerner. It is a sword, and it is there to help us discern what's going on with our beings as well. Hallelujah. "For that which I do not do, I allow not." See, he was talking to me, like in the book of Hebrews, you don't have to put this down, Brother Paul, but my mind come to Hebrews. Let me get there real quick. Mine was talking about the word. It says, "For the word of Yah is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing." You may say it's making a separation, asunder of soul and spirit, and of the joints and the marrows, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of what? The heart. So that's what Paul is trying to give us an understanding of. Try to discern who we are, what we are. As many of us know by Scripture, we know our heart is evil and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Who can know it? Who can know it? Praise Yah. Bless you, Brother Spinney. Bless you all that has joined us in this late, we're just about, about 19 minutes into it. I'm talking again tonight. I'm finishing up on members, sin, lust, and the body of sin. We're in Romans chapter 7. Romans chapter 7, verse 14. I'm talking about Paul here. You know, he starts out talking about the law being spiritual, but he sees himself as being carnal, sold under sin. Then he goes on to, and he goes into an explanation of that carnality that he sees within himself that is sold under sin. And he says in verse 15, For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. You know, that he's something he wants to do, and he purposes to do it, but he finds himself doing the complete opposite. And he says, goes again, here you got Paul, the apostle of Christ. You know, him, in a spirit of humility, even himself, you know, being revered as an apostle, he's breaking down simplicity, what's going on in all believers, even, you know, at his setting and walk with Yeshua. You know, he was an apostle. And many of us, you know, will deem an apostle like real close up there with the Most High Yah, almost in connection, you know, with the Most High Yah. Because an apostle is basically, you know, if you look at the tiers, you know, it's apostle, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. If you want to look at it in that, but it's still going on, say, these all for the perfecting of the saints, the edifying of the body. And they all have their administrations. They all have their purpose, as in teaching and edifying and building up the body. But Paul, you know, as an apostle, he was there to establish churches and establish doctrine. And here he is now, you know, a man, you know, having this great authority and this great work and business on his back. And he's pretty much, you know, breaking it down, you know, that what's going on in him, you know, is going on even at the very youngest believer, as they come into this knowledge of spiritual warfare. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. And we can see that in every one of us. At times, like I say again, I already read, you know, when we desire to do good, we see that evil is present there as well to subvert that good that we want to do. And then sometimes, you know, we want to do other things that are righteous and just and holy. Well, we find ourselves doing the complete opposite. So that's what Paul is starting to bring to our forefront in our mind here, the carnality of our being. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says in verse 16, if then I, he's talking about Paul here, he's talking in, that I, he's breaking it down, talking, you know, he's making a discerner. He's bringing the word to bring a discernment between the soul and the spirit, the thoughts and the intents of the heart. If then I do that which I would not, said if he's doing contrary to righteousness, he says, I consent now unto the law that it is good. And the law is good. It is something going on in the spiritual with this law that so many religious institutions, so many churches out here, would, you know, they have purposed a doctrine that it's done away with. Why do you want to do away with something that is spiritually good to you? A law that is, you know, hanging on two commandments. Love the Lord thy Yah, love Yahweh thy Elohim, with all thy heart, mind, body, soul, spirit. The second likened to the first, love thy neighbor as thyself. And I'm looking at this, you know, and it's always spiritual. Then you can keep wondering, you know, since, you know, you see a lot of these congregations, institutions, businesses of Christ hollering the law is done away with. How many of us, you know, have actually seen love working, you know, with institutions that actually put forth this type of doctrine? You know, I've sat back and thought about that, you know. How do you do away with love? And if you do away with love, and then you read later on in John, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, that Yah is love. So you keep wondering, you know, you start putting line upon line, precept upon precept. What are they really saying? What is spiritually being said here? If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Verse 17, now then, it is now then, it is no more what? I that do it. What's it doing? The sin. Because if he's doing that which he would not, then he's pretty much spiritually, he's consenting unto the law that it is good. That's what he's saying there. Now then it is no more I that do it. So if there is something there that's doing contrary to what he wants to do according to pleasing the Most High, doing righteousness, doing good, if he's desiring that, but he sees something opposite going on, then his very action is propelling and saying that the law is good. Then he goes on and says that because he's doing this and he's considering that the law is good, then he says, and then it's no more I that do it. Do what? The sin, the thing that's contrary. The thing that he hates, but he finds himself doing. He says, no more I that do it, but sin. But sin that dwelleth in me. Can we start understanding? Can we start letting this sword make a discerner of the thoughts and intents of our heart? Because, you know, these spirits, these demons that, you know, like to speak in our heads sometimes, like, you know, to make suggestions to do this, to do that. Evil things that are there on our side continually to contradict the good. How many times you hear these spirits, these demons, speaking to you with your own voice? And they try to persuade you that it is you that is wanting this. It is you that is desiring this. It is you. But Paul says you got to understand now what is animating you to do that which is contrary to Yah, since the law is spiritual. It's not you doing it, but there's actually something else in you that's doing it. He said, but sin that dwelleth in me. So we got to understand anytime there is a temptation, like the word said before, why is there a temptation present? Then we got to see what sin first is dwelling in us. So, because the sin has got to be there first to allow for the grounds of temptation. See, it all fits together. This spiritual world, it is, we got to understand it was framed by the Word of Yah, and it operates by the Word of Yah, and it cannot go outside of the boundaries. Just as the sea, by a perpetual degree, even though it might be a lot of water there, it still has to stay within the boundaries of the shore according to the Word of Yah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But he says, but sin that dwells in me. He says, everything that's going on for which I allow not, but what I would that I do not, but what I hate that do I, if then I do that which I would not. Then he's saying pretty much the whole kip and caboodle is it is sin that's dwelling in him and not him. But these spirits would like to animate us to do many things and then have us to believe that it's us doing it. See, these are vessels. We are just, like Peter said, I'm going to shortly put off this my temporary tabernacle. And we here in this blog talk room, we got a short time here on this earth. Because it seemed like, you know, way time is going for us. And, you know, it's always a unique thing. It seems like as we get older, time gets faster. And then we lose grip of time. So, you know, like a blink of an eye, we can go from 5 years old to 15 years old. And it's amazing, you know, it's just trying to hold on to time itself in this existence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But it's an amazing thing. He's trying to make a division here. Trying to make a division here between the sin that dwelleth in us and our own being. Who we are. Then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Then he goes on in verse 18. For I know that in me, notice that, let's take our time, for I know, Paul knows, and he's trying to get us to know this very thing. For I know that in me, that is, in my flesh. Now, he's making a distinction here. Now, I know that in, for I know that in me, because he got through saying before, but sin that dwelleth in me. Then he goes on, verse 18, for I know that in me, that is, my flesh. What did he say? Dwelleth no good thing. So we can say, hey, sin is no good thing. So he may start making an understanding here of what's dwelling in him. He's got sin animating his body in some form, some way that, you know, he himself, what he purposed to do, that the law that is spiritual in him tells him, you know, to do this, but he sees something else contrary doing other things. For I know that is in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. He says, for to will is present. I know what to do. I know what is righteous. I know what is just. I know what is pure. For to will is present with me. But how to perform that which is good, I find not. Why? What is he talking after? Why is he talking after it? That he's talking about his flesh, that in that it dwelleth no good thing, that in his flesh, that in him he finds sin that's doing these things. Again, he goes on to say, to bring it a little bit deeper, verse 19, for the good that I would, I do not. For the good that I would, for the good that I would, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. So he's still making a correlation. The evil that he's seeing, that he which he would not, he is relating it to what was in the flesh. The evil is what's in him that dwelleth no good. It's the sin that dwelleth in him. See, many people have a problem with Romans 7, but it's clear when you take it slow and start understanding how fearfully and wonderfully made we are. Because, you know, we're going to read all this, but in verse 8 it says, now there is therefore now no condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. After that understanding, he's trying to get us to an understanding to get us out of the realms of condemnation that sin wants to bring sometimes. So he's trying to make a difference between the spiritual man and the carnal man. Because the spiritual man serves a spiritual law. We see you out here in the physical realm, we can perform many physical laws. There are so many physical laws in this world, it's amazing. They got laws for everything, and even now, as they're tightening down on this one world system, there's going to be more physical laws imposed on us. But we that are of the knowledge of the spiritual law, we're going to have our patience tried. As you read in Revelations, here's the patience of the saints, they that keep the commandments of Yah. That's where our patience is going to be dealt at, in the realm of obedience and keeping the commandments of Yah. But getting back to Romans 7 again, I don't want to get off course here. Get off course. He says, for the good that I would. Notice a lot of eyes in here. We got to understand here, what eye is he talking about? Is he talking about the eye of the spiritual man and then the eye of the carnal man? Yeah, he's doing a comparison with the both. Because he sees in himself something spiritual, and he sees himself also something carnal. He sees in him, in his flesh, dwelleth no good thing, that he sees sin dwelling in him. He sees evil, which he would not to do, he's doing. But the evil that he's doing is not after the spiritual man, but it's after a carnal man. Again, in verse 20, after he said that, you know, he's trying to bring a comparison and show us who we are, who the kind of beings that we are. The Most High Yah wants us to get our minds more to being inclined to knowing that we are a more spiritual being than we are a temporal, carnal, physical being. Because in life on this earth, it's just a vapor. But he says, you know, we that are born again, we that are born into regeneration, we're not going to die. The second death is not going to have nothing on us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He says in verse 20, now, if I do that, I would not. It is no more I that do it. What again? Now, if I do that, I would not. It is no more I. Which eye is he talking about? He's not talking about his real eye, his real regenerated eye, his real regenerated person, but he's talking about the person that actually is going to do it. And now, if I do that, I would not. Now, if I, there's one part of his being, do that, I would not. There's a part of him that's, you know, a part of his being saying, don't do it. But there's a part of his being saying, do it. He sees this fight going on within him. Now, if I do that, I would not. It is no more I. He's trying to bring this home. He's trying to really drive this home. And this is the second time that he has said this. It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Verse 21, I says, I find then a law, another realm of precepts and commandments, another thing that is telling me to do this, that's telling me to do that. I find then a law that when I would do good, there's a law, he's talking about a certain law that's going on in him. I find then a law that when I would do good, his purpose to do good, evil is present with me. Verse 22 says, For I delight, and that I is the one that always wants to do good, to do righteous, to do holiness, to please the Most High. For I delight in the law of Yah. How? After the inward man. Now, see, he's starting to make a difference now. See, we got to understand we have an outward man and we have an inward man. Just as in the tabernacle of old, it had skins of animals on the outside, but it had gold on the inside. Amen. For I delight, the real Paul delights in the law of Yah after the inward man. But he says in verse 23, in his discernment and knowing himself, and how many of us actually take time to take inventory of knowing ourselves? But I see another law in my members. Where is it at? In my members. Warring against the law of my mind. See, he's talking about one law. He says that when I would do good, evil is present with me. That's this law he's talking about there. But I see another law in my members. And so what's this law in his members? He says that law that is when he wants to do good, evil is present with him. There's a law there. But I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity. In captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members. The law of Yah is not in the members, but the law of sin, he said, is in my members. And then he says, you know, unto the consummation of knowing all this, you know, and falling down to the ground and just going, whoo! He said in verse 24, he said, like we do many a times when we fall down to the ground before the Most High Yah, we say, oh, wretched man that I am. He's hollering, who shall deliver me from the body? Notice that. He's calling it a body, the body of sin. Who's going to deliver me from the body of this death? He's making a definite discernation. He's making a definite determination about this certain type of death. This same law that is in his members that when he wants to do good, evil is present with him. And what is that in his members? Sin. Sin, he said, no, it's no longer I. That I've come to an understanding now. I have a part of me that wants to do good, but I see another part of me. I see another realm of my body performing that which I would not. It's doing that which I hate. And then he says, Now I know what's going on. I've got to understand that it's not me doing it, but it's sin. It's sin. So I can have to separate the sin from me. I have to separate the sin that I desire to serve after the inward man, and I have to separate it and kill off the thing that is warring in my members. said, oh, wretched man that I am, knowing that this is going on. And just his being, because he can just see it going on, you know, in the spirit of his mind. He can just discern his body, all everything going on in his body. Many of us at any time have desired to do good and do pleasant things, but we see our body animating and doing things that we would not do. Then we condemn ourselves. Instead of doing like Paul said, now I know what it is that's causing me to do this. It is sin. It is sin. It is sin. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? God, that body, that law of sin, that thing that's worn in his members, will have a payday. It will bring him to death. And it's amazing when we look at the word death. We can look at it in physically, and you know, when it, we can say that someone ceases to live. But in the spirit, how can we actually give a good definition of death? I can say it's in one word: separation. 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 Because you know, any time that we find ourselves in sin, we found that our body has animated and it's been found in sin. Now all of a sudden our communication with the Most High Yah, our peace, our everything is separated from us. Everything that was good, everything comes crashing down, and now we're separated from the Most High Yah. But that inward man, knowing that we're now been severed, our relationship has been severed by this sin, now he goes into motion to get back and reconcile himself back to Yah. That's why repentance is such a beautiful thing, to get us back in right with Yah. When we acknowledge in our minds and our hearts that we sinned against the most holy Yah, and we fall on our face and cry out for mercy, and then accept the blood, and then call upon the blood to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That inward man, all of a sudden knowing now that the outward man has tainted the garment. Now that body, that pure body, is desiring to fellowship back with the Most High Yah. Okay, you need to look at it in the sense of a physical body. You know, we live in a world where there's a lot of pathogens, a lot of germs, a lot of infections, a lot of this, a lot of that, that's always on the outside trying to attack our outward bodies. But you notice at any time, these fearfully and wonderfully made physical bodies, and any time when something foreign enters in, that the body goes into defense mode to eradicate itself of that which should not be there. This is the same in our spiritual body. It goes into attack mode at any time when sin is in the camp, when transgression is in the camp, when iniquity is in the camp. And it is a good thing. And, you know, we in ourselves, we should not deter from falling from on our faces before the Most High Yah just to get back in fellowship with Him. Hallelujah. 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 As we see now, that it is not us that's doing it. And we realize that it's not doing it. But we're going to fall on our faces. We're going to call upon the one that loved us, even while we was yet in our sin, hung on a tree, took that flesh that was contrary to us, nailed it to the cross, and everything that pertained to that flesh, and killed it on the cross. And now we can say, afterward, repentance has done its deed, the blood is washed, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. He wants us to walk after the Spirit because we are spiritual beings. He wants our minds to get in a spiritual manner because we got a kingdom, a spiritual kingdom that we're going to. This heaven and this earth that we live on now is corrupted, it's tainted, it's dirty, it's vile. It's got to be destroyed by fire. And there's a new heavens and a new earth waiting for us. And we got to purge ourselves. We've got to go through the fire, the baptism of fire. He's going to baptize us with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And what the fire is going to do is going to purge us, purge out of our being all corruptness, all sins, everything out of us. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Most High Yah for that. Verse 25 again of Romans 7. I thank Yah through Jesus Christ, our Master, our Most High. He says, so then with what? So then with what? The mind. I myself serve the law. So what is in us? What is that part of our body, that spiritual body, that is going to serve Yeshua HaMashiach? So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of Yah. That's why it was written in our hearts, in our minds, so that we can serve Him. And we got to start separating the two. See, with my mind, I know in my mind the law of Yah is there. So that's why that war is there. I know what to do good. But I see this body of sin, this body of this death, doing other things contrary to what I know what is right in my mind. So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of Yah. But he said, but with the flesh, but with the flesh, but with the flesh, the law of sin. So that's why we see all through the epistles, let not sin reign in your mortal bodies. Because we, like pastors, reiterated today, we see what's a lot of people, the diseases and the things that they deal with in their bodies is because of the realms of sin. Therefore, don't let sin reign in your mortal body. Because what sin is doing, what is the wages of sin? It is death. It is that body of this death. The thing that's warring in our members, trying to make our hands and our feet and our heart and our eyes and our tongue and our ears do that contrary, which is to the law of Yah. Hallelujah. 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 It's amazing. Amazing. Go back, and I'm going to go over James 4 again on this very note. James chapter 4. All right. James. So going to pick up a little bit, and then we're going to go into the member saints. He goes on again. Now we got an understanding of how we're serving the law of Yah. We're serving it with our mind. And then he made a distinct separation there. How is the law of sin being served in us? It's by the flesh. He made a correlation. What was going on? There is the law of the flesh working against the law that is in our mind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's right. That's right. Don't let sin reign in our mortal bodies. Because you see, in the very beginning, there was an Adam, there was an Eve. Adam was told, you know, hey, of every tree of the garden, you may freely eat. But the tree which is in the middle, the midst of the garden, the knowledge of the good and evil, you shall not eat of it. But we see that that Eve got sold a bill of bad sale. We had a salesman sitting in the tree trying to sell her some ungodly wisdom. Trying to sell her a piece of bad fruit. And his sales pitch was very, very convincing to the woman that she actually took of the fruit, did eat, and gave to her husband also. And they died. And they died. Next thing you know, their eyes were open. Just as the serpent said, your eyes shall be open, and you shall know good and you shall be as God. You know, he said, here he is, waking up the flesh. You know, talking to the flesh of man. Hey, look, look, look. Fruit, it's there to make thee wise. It's good to eat. It's yummy, yummy, yummy. It's got very good taste. Hey, and you shall know. You're going to know everything that Yah knows. You know, he's keeping stuff away from you. Come on, eat it. Eat it. It's there. It's free. Freely eat. And then when they did eat, then they saw and looked down upon themselves that they were naked. And then shame. Shame. Shame caused them to go hide themselves. And then in the cool of the day. And in the cool of the day. Most High comes to walk with Adam. And Adam. Adam. Where are you? I'm over here. I'm over here. I'm hiding. I'm naked. Who told thee that thou was naked? Well, you know, that sermon and woman, you know, the buck passing and everything. You see now where I got that, you know, that death that happened to Adam and Eve. They separated themselves and went and hid themselves away from the Most High God. So that's something that partook in them spiritually. First, when they transgressed the Most High God's law and word in the garden. There was only one law. Don't eat. Don't eat. Don't eat. Don't eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. One law. He couldn't do that. And then man was separated from paradise. That's why we got the first man, Adam, was earthly. By one man, sin entered into the world and death by sin. But I thank the Most High Yah for the second Adam, which was made a quickening spirit, bringing many sons into salvation. He's the captain of our salvation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who's going to deliver us from the body of this death when we holler, "Oh, wretched man that I am, I have sinned against thee, Most High Yah. I need that cleansing blood. I need the cleansing power of the blood. I want to be clean. I like being clean spiritually, Most High Yah. I don't like this feeling of being spiritually dirty." You know what is crying out within us? It's that Holy Spirit. That body, that law that is in that mind that's propelling us to fall on our knees. Because you know the law of sin, that thing which is in our flesh, it would not fall to its knees and then tell on itself, no, 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 no. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. James 4, 1. It says, from whence come wars in fightings among you? He's asking us a question. Now, all this war and everything that's going on within you and among you, hey, where are they coming from? What is the meaning of this? What is the genesis of all this? What caused it to come about? From whence come wars and fightings among you? Say, come they not hence, even of your what? Lust. You mean these wars are hinged on lust? That's what it's saying. From whence come wars and fightings among you? Question mark. James said, come they not hence even of your lust? Lust got to be there first. Then comes the wars and the fightings among you. There's got to be a foundation of lust, a legal ground that lust presents, that lust allows for these fightings and wars to come among us. Come they not hence, even of the lust that war in where? In members? What did Paul say? I find then in my flesh dwelleth no good. I find in me evil. I find in me sin. Come they not hence, even of your lust that war. These lust war in your members. And then with all these demons, boy, they fight and they gnash on each other with teeth. And you ever seen somebody that is just overtaken in lust? You know how degraded, how demolished they look, how depressed they are, how downcast they are? When all these lusts are just going on within and fighting and biting and devouring one another. Come they not hence, even if your lust said war. The lust are warring in your members. They're animating something in our members. This sin is performing something in our members. It's animating something in our body. It's causing these motions of sins. It's something that has come in spiritually in a unique way, and now it's starting to funnel itself spiritually. It's amazing that these demons, they don't attack us in the spirit, but they attack us outwardly. They're outward beings. They cannot read our thoughts, but they sure can read our reactions. It's amazing. They're not omniscient like the Most High Yah. Satan is not omniscient like the Most High Yah, and not omnipresent either. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. From whence come wars and fightings among? Come they not even of your lust at war in your members? Says ye lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have. Just think. Just think the lust of this world. You know, all these, this great nation going out into other nations, lusting after resources. And they kill and they plunder and they steal. And they still don't obtain. And because they still are not obtained, their lust is not fulfilled to the max where they want it. Their lust drives them even further to try to fulfill itself. And even as this lust don't even fulfill itself, it drives itself on for more fulfillment. And you know that this lust, the eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. It's not going to be satisfied. Ye lust and have not. You want to obtain, they want to obtain all these great resources, and in the end, they don't have it. They plunder it. They squander it. They do away with it. They might obtain it in some fashion or form, but still, it's just like sand in their hands. They can't hold on to it. They lust. Ye lust and have not. Why can't we obtain certain things that we're lusting after? Because it's not meant to be after the vehicle of lust. Ye lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. You know, and this war and this fighting that's going on within us causes us, and the fightings and the wars to go on and deeper and richer, if not, and they're not taken a hold of. Ye lust and have not. Ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain. Ye fight and war, yet ye have not, because ye ask not. Ye ask and receive not, because ye ask amiss. Why? One vehicle only that is working in the members, that ye may consume it upon your lust. So lust is the big belly. So lust is the big fat thing that's dwelling in us that can never be fulfilled. It's got an insatiable appetite. Even though it might obtain it in itself, it still hasn't attained it. And because it still hasn't attained what it really wants to attain, it starts fighting and warring even more. Oh, wow. Wow. It's an amazing thing, saints. Amazing things. I'm going to get a little small drink of water here. I'm going to do a quick station break here if I can find it. There we go. Bless you, saints. I shall return.
We're glad to have each and every last one of you here tonight listening to us on Blog Talk Radio. This is Pastor Dow. If you'd like to contact us, our phone number is area code 615-688-3025. That is, again, 615-688-3025. If you'd like to correspond with us, or if you'd like to support this particular ministry with your gifts, your offerings, or letter of support, you can send it to Pastor Charles Dowell. That is Pastor Charles Dowell, and the last name is spelled D-O-W-E-L-L. That is Pastor Charles Dowell. You can send your letter to 632 Highway 52 Bypass West. That's 632 Highway 52 Bypass West, PMB number 1, Lafayette, Tennessee. And Lafayette is spelled L-A-F-A-Y-E-T-T-E, Tennessee. And the area code is 37083. Again, the mailing address is Pastor Charles Dowell, Highway 632, 52 Bypass West, PMB number 1, Lafayette, Tennessee, 37083. Our website is www.straightwaytruth.com, and that is spelled StraitwayTruth.com. That is the StraitwayTruth.com or StraitwayTruth.com. You can also find us on YouTube. If you would go to YouTube and type in my name, Pastor Dowell, PastorDowell. There, you can find many teaching videos. We preach and teach on just about everything that the Scriptures has to offer. We also have a Bible deliverance ministry. We teach people about health. And we also speak to you about how important it is to obey the covenant of the Most High. We hope to hear from you, you and you. That is our prayer. The King is coming.
All right. Praise Yah, saints. Welcome back. Praise Yah. That's right, Sister Diana. Mortify the deeds of the flesh. Anyone wonder what these deeds are in the flesh? What's causing these deeds? Sin, evil, that is present with us. That body of this death. Mortify means to kill. We got to become professional mercenaries, professional hitmen against the flesh. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise Yah. Again, James, let's flip back a few chapters. James chapter 1, starting at verse 12. This thing is something else. It seems like, you know, saints, it's a complex thing to try to understand, but it really isn't. You really look at it the way Paul is breaking it down, where we was in Romans 7, and then James, the way he's breaking it down, it's really simple. It's really simple for the child of Yah to understand. If we allow. You know, Pastor was bringing that forth today. You know, it's got to be an injunction, an inflection, a volition of our will in a lot of what we do. And I was telling that to a brother today. You know, you got to really watch your volitions. You got to watch your will. And I also was telling him, you know, it's amazing. It's amazing. You know, we as saints of the Most High Yah, and a lot of us, you know, are coming into this warfare and learning of the spiritual warfare. And I told him about the realm of yielding. You know, and I've heard a lot of brothers, you know, come to me and, you know, say, I can't, you know, I'm finding it hard to yield to the Holy Spirit, you know, and the righteous spirits and everything. You know, and I pretty much, you know, meditate on that. And I'm going, yield? Why are you having a problem yielding? And then, you know, I rehearsed to him. I said, you don't have no problems yielding to unholy spirits and devils and demons, huh? It seems like something within, you know, the believer. Something going on, that war going on in believer, that, you know, the yielding sometimes is a lot easier to the demons and to the flesh and to unrighteous thoughts and to ungodly things. You know, sometimes it seems like, you know, the way he was saying that the yielding is easier. Yielding to that, and then it is a labor to yield to the Most High God. And I told him, no, it's the same mechanism. It's used in both realms. But it's according to your will. Are you going to yield to the lust of the flesh? Are you going to yield your will to the law of Yah? That was Paul was trying to say there. But you know, many people find themselves, you know, it's a lot easier. There's no labor, they say it's no labor in yielding to the ungodliness. But I told him, I said, now, you take the strength of that yield that you're yielding to ungodly spirits, ungodly thoughts and everything, and turn it around. Start using, you know, that strength that you're yielding that way, turn it around, and start yielding it toward the Most High Yah. Because it's amazing, you know, how the Most High Yah turned Saul around, who was, you know, a heavy persecutor of the church, killed everyone that was of the followers of Jesus, and turned that volition, turned that will, turned, you know, his purpose that was so driven against the church, turned that purpose to be for the church. So it's an amazing thing that the Most High Yah can do in us if we allow him to do it. Because if we yield our will to the devils are there to animate and to partake and to oblige your will in that manner. Just as the Most High Yah, seeing that you have yielded yourself to him and to the godly spirits, to the spirits of wisdom, love, joy, peace, if you yield to them and your will is toward them, then will your being be animated in that manner. So we see we got a great war going on in us saints. And it's according to whom we will choose to serve this day. And upon every waking moment, when we wake up in the morning, that's got to have that decision. It's got to take place. And then throughout the day, that decision place is going on continually. Am I going to do this or am I going to do that? Am I going to do right? Am I going to do wrong? What voice am I hearkening myself to? What voice am I listening to? Because we got the voice of ungodliness on one side, then we got the voice of Yah on the other. And then we got to choose between the two. And it's got to be an invoking, a volition of our will, who we will choose. Hallelujah. And in James 1:12, it says, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, semicolon. For when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life. He means if he overcomes the temptation. If he overcomes, and then he receives the reward of living. But if he don't overcome and the temptation overcomes him, then he's in separation. Then he's in death. But you see here, if the man endureth the temptation and he makes it high above it and excels above it, he's going to receive a crown of life, which Yeshua hath promised to them that love him. There's that another volition of the will. If we have that love toward the Most High Yah tethered in our will, to help propel our will to do right, to help our mind, our will, and our emotions to steer it towards the Most High Yah. While at the same time we're steering toward the Most High Yah, we see also present with us evil. It's always going to be present with us. I told the brother, I said, man, this is the war. No matter what you're going to do, you're going to have evil present with every good thing that you do. That's the way this existence is framed right now. And we, the people of Yah, knowing that this world is not our home, because we don't want to call a place that this crap is going on like this our home. We don't want to lay our head here. No, we're just passing through. Our life is a vapor. And if we endure this great temptation to the end, we shall be saved. Because we look before us and we see every great thing in this physical world. We got to understand it's a veil. It is a veil. It is a distraction. What is real? What is real? What can we say that is real for Israel? Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. That is how we walk. And we walk in the Spirit. And the Most High God is always trying to get our minds on the spiritual side instead of the carnal, fleshly side. Like James said, blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which Yeshua hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of Yah, for Yah tempted cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. So we see here who's doing the tempting, huh? Says, then it's got semicolon here. He's making the correlation here now, who's doing the temptation. Yah is not doing the temptation. But there's something in us that actually will yield to temptation or endure temptation. Verse 14 says, but every man is tempted. How is he tempted? How is he tempted? What is the grounds for temptation? Because we just got through reading Paul making the great division between the body of the Spirit and the body of sin, serving the law of Yah with his mind and serving the law of sin with his flesh. Then we see here now, James is still talking about this law, this thing that is in our members, which it precipitates a lot of these warrings and fightings. It says, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust. Lust has to be there first before the temptation can enter. He's drawn away of his own lust and is enticed. So what was that serpent doing to Eve? What was she wakening? What is he wakening up in Eve? She was drawn away by that salesman, that serpent, telling her everything that this fruit was going to do for her. He appealed to her lust. And he was able to allow lust by her hearing his words, by her yielding to the voice of the serpent, that lust entered into her, and she was enticed, and she yielded. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust. Can you kind of wonder what was going on in Eve's mind? You know, how many days you might have walked in that garden, eaten of every tree, and then there's that one tree in the midst of the garden that was mystery. I wonder why the Most High Yah don't want us to eat of that. I wonder what's special about that tree. She must have gotten very close to it enough to hear the voice of the serpent. And you know, that same tree is even presented to us today. You know, we got the tree of life. You know, when we wake up, we can wake up and go over to the tree of life and pick from it and live. Or we can make the decision to go over here to the tree of the knowledge of good and evil and die. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. But it says, but when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. It's got to be conceived for. It's got to be acted on first. When it's actually animated. And it is acted upon. And sin, when it is finished, bringing forth death. Back in James again, we left off talking about the little member called the tongue. James starts talking about this little member. Said he in James 3, verses 5 and 6, he says, Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Called it a member now. And what's warring in our members? Lust and sin. Even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth. And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members. So is the tongue a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members. What does it do? The tongue among our members, what does it do? It defileth what? The whole body. The whole body. And it says it setteth on fire the course of nature. What's it mean in there? Set it on fire the course of nature. A course in the Greek is the word Genesis. Let me look at that. Or is it either course or nature? I think nature has a Greek definition of, I think it's 1067. Let me look at that real quick. 1078. Yes, nature is Genesis. 1078, that's nature. Set it on fire. The course of nature. And it's set on the fire of hell. So the word nature, 1078, is the Greek word Genesis. Means origin, origination, the beginning of existence. So this tongue, these words that it speaks, it sets on fire. It sets the course for a lot of things in our lives. And it is set on the fire of hell. For every kind of beast and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. So therewith what? The tongue, bless we Yah, even the Father, and therewith this tongue, curse we man. We go bless the Father on Sabbath. Then the next day we'll go curse a man. We'll get mad at somebody. We'll get bitter at somebody. And that same tongue will do, that same tongue which was blessing the Most High and praising the Most High, it finds itself all of a sudden the next day blaspheming, cursing, belittling, gossiping, tearing down a man, a friend, a relative, a brother, a sister. Therewith bless we Yah, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of Yah. That out of the same mouth proceedeth blessings and cursings. Said, my brethren, these things ought not to be. It's true. And it's true. Hebrews 11 again tells us that the worlds were framed by the word of Yah. So if the Most High Yah just spoke and things came into being, we ourselves are to liken ourselves not to be as gods, our God, but understand as spiritual beings that our words take on more weight now in this regeneration than when we were sinners. We got to really understand, saints, that the structure of our words, the things which come out of our mouth, have a greater weight in this walk than they ever have been in our whole life. Because it's amazing when this time comes in the end, when we are supposed to give an account of every deed done this body, we're going to be doing it with words. And then there's going to be a time when we're brung amongst our persecutors and our captivators and whoever it may be, then the Holy Spirit is going to rise up in us and speak something out of us. It's going to be by the word of our testimony that we're going to overcome this anti-Messiah, that we're going to overcome this beast. We see the beast system even right now being set up little by little by little. And the voice of the false prophet has been sounding already through many centuries. And we think that this thing called Revelation is off in the future. No, it's even now. Even when Christ and the disciples were on this earth, he was calling it the last time, the last days. And here we are at the last day. There's a lot of things, like I know I've always heard. I see on the chat board here, Daughter Seeking Truth said, speaking things into existence. Well, let's just take the realm of fear. How the spirit of fear plays on our mind. You know, a lot of people could probably relate to this. Just say you're walking out, you know, from a lighted building, and you know you're out in another state in a place you're not familiar with, and you're walking out into pitch black darkness. And you stop a moment and then let your eyes, you know, try to adjust. Then all of a sudden, you know, rising up in you, you know, you hear a voice, a little sound here, a little sound over there, you know, and this and that. And all of a sudden, you know, something speaks in your mind. There's something going to get you. There's something out there going to attack you. There's something over in that bush. You know, here you are in the dark. You can't see. But all of a sudden, there's something speaking in your mind trying to get you to see these things. Or try to tell you these things are going on in the dark. Even though they're not there, these things are making suggestions into your mind, the things that are not there, as though they were there. Then the next thing you know, if a person is actually taking time to listen to these words, these lies of things that were not there, next thing you know, they're actually seeing things that are not there. They're believing things. There's a ghost over there. There's a haunted thing over there. You know, trying to get me. There's something sitting over there in the corner. And their mind's racing. And they got this picture in their mind. And their heart's racing. Their whole being is all of a sudden entombed in this realm of fear. Out of something that isn't there but was introduced to the mind. Your Daughter Seeking Truth says, I was wondering if it meant by setting on fire the course of nature. What I'm saying is, a lot of our words will determine how we react hereafter. Just like, you know, a conversation between two angry people. If one person is saying one thing angry against the person, and then it's volleyed back in another angry way, then that angry thing starts steering that conversation to more and to more and to more anger. But if you know, if we see, you know, if we take the time to discern that anger's, you know, in the presence, and we start speaking soft words, you know, calm words that will seek to turn away wrath, then we'll actually start seeing courses of nature being turned. Because you read in James 3, you know, it's talking about, you know, the rudder on a great ship. You know, even though it's a little member, it steers where that boat is going. And then it says, and then in the same sense, it says we put bridles in the horse's mouth, that, you know, that we will turn them left or turn them right. And even though it be a little thing, it's turning, it's directing the course of things. And it's using the horse and the ship as, you know, an example of how our tongue steers things in our lives. It's like one time, you know, I drawed on the board last time that I was giving the scripture study. You know, we feel sometimes symptoms of sickness coming upon us. And, you know, a lot of times when I'm out at Walmart, I feel sometimes these things come because I'm out in the public and there's a lot of people carrying all kinds of germs and everything. And sometimes I feel the presence of something coming on me. And because, you know, I'm sober and I'm spiritually aware and knowing these things are coming upon me, I start rebuking them. I start framing words and start speaking against them things, telling, you know, most of the time what I'll say is, you know, in the name of Jesus, I'm a steward over this body. And I feel what you're trying. You're trying to bring on a scratchy throat. You're trying to bring a headache on me. And in the name of Jesus, being a steward over this own body, I take authority over you because I got to give an account of the deeds done in this body. And in the name of Jesus, I rebuke you. I don't receive none of what you're trying to put upon my body. I will not receive your symptoms in the name of Jesus. And then I leave it at that, and I go back to work. And then an hour later, I don't have no symptoms. The thing that was there an hour before that was trying to weigh me down is all of a sudden disappeared. Why? Because, you know, I spoke words in authority, not of my own, but speaking the authority which Yeshua had given me. Now, that's just a small example, you know, of how, you know, our daily conversation can steer many things. Somebody can, you know, speak to us pleasantly and we retract back, you know, not understanding, you know, they might be there, you know, trying to give us direction. You know, like trying to tell us that, you know, you're dealing with this spirit and you're dealing with this sin, but there's something in us that rises up and say, no, I'm not there, and then you retract back at them. Then you start setting a course right after that in your own nature. In your own nature. So are words important? Are words important? Like Diana Martin, if it means life and death, there's a power of this tongue. We can build our life by our words. That's right. So as Paul was talking about, I got a spiritual mind and I got a carnal thing going on within me. You know, I can speak, you know, out of the law that's worn in my members and start speaking death, or I can start speaking according to the law of my mind and start living in life. Even though all this stuff may be going on around me, I will speak the word of Yah that says, you know, this thing should not be so. I will stand on the word of Yah even though everything else is looking contrary to it. I will stand on the word of Yah to keep the Sabbath day, to keep it holy, even though everything around us and everybody saying keep Sunday. So that's just many examples, you know, and many facets that we can really look at this with, you know, and it's according to our will, how we're going to steer our volition. Because we got to understand that this spiritual warfare does start in our thoughts first. And a lot of our spiritual warfare can be won victoriously right at the onset if we would just take everything captive like the word tells us to do. Bring into everything into the obedience of Christ. Because we're getting, at any time of the day, a lot of strange stuff being interjected in our mind, trying, you know, using our own voice, you know, trying to deceive us, that you know, hoping that we think it's us that's projecting these things. But Paul said, no, that is not I that's doing it. But there is some kind of sin in me that's speaking in me to do these things. So he's making a correlation. He was making a dividing asunder there of what was going on within his being so that he would know how to discern the thoughts and the intents of what was going on in his heart so that he can make the right decisions. So he come to the conclusion, yeah, I've got the law of Yah, so with my mind I'm going to serve that. But I know this flesh, all it can do is serve the law of sin. With my flesh, I'm going to serve the law of sin. So that's why the scriptures keep telling us and the word and the epistles keep telling us, mortify therefore the deeds of the flesh. That's why we got to yield our tongue to the Holy Spirit. It's an amazing thing, you know, when the Holy Spirit comes upon a person, when a person is baptized in the Spirit, then the Holy Spirit, the last thing that it takes hold of once the person is filled is that tongue. And it causes that tongue to speak a heavenly language to magnify the Most High Yah. And it does that. It does that to actually help seal the whole body. Because once the tongue starts magnifying and glorifying Yah, then the whole body is submersed in that blessing and in that magnifying of Yah. Because we see, you know, if that tongue is doing, you know, speaking according to the law of sin within us, then the whole body starts getting defiled. But if you just think, if that tongue is yielded to righteousness and holiness and purity, then the whole body is immersed in that very thing that tongue is speaking. When we, you know, anytime that we're praising and worshiping, we're singing words, we're speaking in tongues. And, you know, the more we express the love in our heart that's the Most High, and we express it with words, and then, you know, that love within us animating our bodies. We got our hands held high, and we're praising the Most High, and we're lifting up, and we're desiring to magnify His name. Then we see that the whole body starts feeling the presence of Yah. It starts bathing itself in the blessings of Yah. Hallelujah. 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 It's only if our volition is yielded. But you know, at the same time, at the moment, know that we can yield to an ungodly thought. It's there present, but we know it's present. We desire not to yield to it. We know it's there on the side to deceive us. But we know we have locked our will, our volition to praise the Most High. All that stuff falls away, you know, and our mind is almost the Most High, and our mind is on nothing else but the Most High. We're immersed. We're being baptized into His worship and in His praise and in His glory. And then when that praise goes up, then we feel the blessings come down upon us, and we feel it in our whole being. The same way when we yield to sin, we feel death permeate our whole being. So in the same likewise way, yield yourself unto life that you can feel life in your whole being. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Most High Yah for that. So that's why I'm saying about framing our words, because we know here we are made and being come back to the spiritual state that Yah made us. We was made like the Most High Yah. He made man in His image. Yah is a spirit. So what is being made in the image of Yah? Not our flesh, but our spirit. Our spirit. Our spirit is learning to love. For Yah is love. Hallelujah. 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 So that's why I'm taking 11:3 as I see the Most High Yah framing worlds with His words. So can we. We can frame the world of fear with just words in our mind. We can frame the world of bitterness in our minds. Just how, look how bitterness talks to us and how it frames our mind when someone has done something wrong to us. Next thing you know, our mind is thinking on vengeance, how much we hate them. They look like this. We don't like this about them. I wish this would happen to them. Just look at that framing. Just look at how that course of that life is that body is being steered just because of that thought pattern. Just think on it. Say, yeah, I mean, it goes deep, but it's still simple to the child of Yah. It's all according to our will and our volition if we desire. Just like Pastor was saying today, you know, Yeshua, as thou wilt, I will, I will, I will. Hallelujah. Mark 7. Mark 7, saints. Praise Yah, I'm over here sweating. Whew. I thank the Most High Yah for that. I kind of like it. I like the fire of Yah. And that's all I like. That's why I like not really preparing a lot of stuff, you know, having everything structured, because I like when the Holy Spirit is actually speaking to me, and then, you know, whatever He's putting in me that I can, dispense it out to y'all, hope, as it's building me up, You know, my hope that it's build you up as well, because we're here, we're helpers one to another. We're in the evil and dark world, saints. And each one of us need one another to, you know, help strengthen one another daily. We need this. We need real, true love that we actually know deep down in each and every one of us, that we love one another and that we care for one another, because we are family. And it is true, spirit is thicker than blood. Blood's going to return back to the dust to where it comes from. But the spirit is returning back to Yah, and it lives on forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And if we can be knitted together in the spirit, hallelujah, the more the better, the greater the army is. Hallelujah. Because we got this damn Hasatan raising up his head in this last day, knowing that he has a short time, showing himself to be like the Most High. He's fashioned this damn world after he's corrupted. He's never been an originator. We can look at this world and see the corruptness of how it is framed, of how it is built up. And we can see that it is, at one time it was a pure thing, a righteous thing, but this damn Hasatan wanted to be like the Most High. He does a complete opposite of that which was holy. One time, he always likes making something that was in a holy state and then bringing it to a profane state. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Mark 7:21. I'm in Luke. Bless y'all. praise y'all. Mark 7:21. Through 23. It says, For from within, out of the heart of men, what happens? There's nothing good about the heart, is it? As in with the talking here, for from within, out of the heart of men proceed what? Evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. All these evil things come from within and defile the man. These defile the man. That's the thing that Paul was talking about. These evil things which was in his members, warring against the law of his mind. What was he serving with his mind? The law of Yah. The same note, we'll read real quick. I think Matthew 15:18 real quick. Says, but those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart. So we can start putting line upon line, precept upon precept. We see here that what was in the heart, the evil thoughts, the adulteries, the fornications, the murders. So out of the heart, the originator, the inner being of man. For those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart, and they defile the man. So you can see now how words will drive a man's course of nature. It will tether his walk and his steps and his thoughts and his ways and his emotions. Just by the simple way that he talks. That's why the Most High Yah, and that's why you hear a pastor continually saying, get the word in your where? Hearts. Get the word in your hearts. Let this thing steer. Let this thing be the rudder and not the things that are warring in the members. The things that are the lust that are seated in the members that allow temptations to come on. Because, you know, if there was no lust there, then there's no grounds for temptation. Matthew 12. I'm still on the tongue. Praise y'all, saints. Sorry, I've been going on and on. Still ain't got to the other members yet. We're still on the tongue. Praise y'all. Matthew 12. 36-37. He says, "But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment." He's talking about idle words, words, things that come out of his mouth. That's what he's saying there simply. I don't think I need to go any great dissertation there, great expounding there. That's cut dry and plain. But in verse 37, it says, "For by thy words, thou shalt be justified, and by thy words, thou shalt be condemned." So that's one saint that put up the scripture before, life and death are in the power of the tongue, and they that love it, and what is it? Life or death, shall eat the fruit thereof. So we can see how great this little member has to be dealt with. This thing steers the whole body. It will steer it to life, and it will steer it to death. Now moving on. Another member that these sins, these lusts, these temptations arise and animate and cause motions of sins to be enacted. Hands. Let's look at hands. Proverbs 6. Proverbs 6:17. I'm going to start at verse 6:16. It says, "These six things does the Most High hate," Yah hate, "even seven are an abomination unto him." It says 17, one, a proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood. Hands that shed innocent blood. And they don't have to shed innocent blood by taking a knife or taking a gun and performing a physical act. There are spiritual hands that do a lot of damage. And there are spiritual tongues, ungodly spiritual tongues, that do a lot of damage. Just think, when a person's in bitterness or in hatred or in anger, the thoughts that goes on in his mind, that there's a tongue speaking in his mind. When a man's volition and his will, when he's contemplating and meditating upon things that he desires to meditate and contemplate on. There's always a communication going on in the thought realm. And that's where the Most High, again, is trying to get us to get a clamp on, to get a hold of this spiritual warfare at its onset, as of taking the battle to the gate, as in controlling our thoughts, controlling the things that are being thought, being said in our mind, and being introduced in our mind. We got to take right now the battle to that front and stop it there before we get into some big, gigantic civil wars. Psalm 115. Psalm 115, saints. Looky here. Psalm 115:4 says, "Their idols are silver and gold." Idols. What is one of the commandments? "Thou shalt have no other Yahs, no other Elohims, no other gods before him." No other Elohims. I didn't mean to say Yahs, but either Elohims, no gods before him. Said their idols are silver and gold. And how are these idols made? The works of men's hands. But you just wonder, what animates these men's hands to make these idols. They've got to get a vision from somewhere. A vision's got to come from some place. It's got to originate from somewhere. They had to pull it out of some existence to make this idol. Wonder where they're pulling the existence of this idol, the likeness of this idol out of. Out of their own minds, out of their own heart. The corrupted mind, the corrupted heart will make these images. And that's what they did back. We read that our brothers and sisters come through the wilderness and went into these lands and they gave themselves over to these idols and these things made with hands, these gold and silver trinkets, these teraphims, and everything serving other gods. But now here we are in this walk of our life, and these idols that we have in our hearts and our minds, they don't have to be fashioned with silver and gold. They begin to be fashioned with our bitterness and our hatred and our disgust and everything that is contrary to the will of Yah can pretty much formulate by the realm of our thoughts these idols that we bow down and worship to. And you got these America bound down to every ungodly idol. And it don't have to be one set up in fashion of silver and gold. But these idols, they are forcing them to go and plunder other countries. To go get their resources and get this and get that. And still, once they did all this and all this destruction, they still have not obtained anything. And their lust causes their hands to perform more and more and more and more. To go after this, kill here, to kill there, to slay innocent blood. Because the lust that is in their members, that is animating these bodies of sin. Hallelujah. Again, back in Proverbs 21. Verse 25. Proverbs 21:25 says, the desire, notice this is something in his heart. This is something in his mind. The desire of the slothful killeth him. He means the desire, there's something formulated in his mind. There's an idol in his mind. There is a visage in his mind. There is a framed thought in his mind. There is some kind of lust in his mind that will cause this slothful man to be killed. What caused him to be slothful to begin with? What did he frame his own being after that caused himself to be slothful? The desire of the slothful killing him. Why? Why? For his hands refuse to labor. So you can start seeing now the motions of sins. And the things which war in our members and causes our members to do certain things. See, we dealt with tongue, and it's yielding to this way or that way, and then we got hands that's doing evil, that's doing ungodliness, that's doing corruptness. But we know in the same manner, we can still yield our members to servants of righteousness. Our hands can build. Our hands can heal. Like Pastor today said, you know, Most High Yah was asked, Yeshua was asked to lay his hands on someone to bring them back to life, to heal them. Notice that, they used the hands for a righteous mean. Use the hands to dispense life. And in the same time, we can use our hands to dispense death. We can use our tongue to dispense life. Use our tongue to dispense death. But we are creations of life, saints. That's why he said these things are not to be so. Blessings and cursings. Our one hand on the right hand wants to build, but our left hand wants to tear down and pluck. So we can understand, you know, we're seeing and look at ourselves, our physical hands, but we can actually see what is actually motivating, what's animating us in the realm of the spirit. Can Again, Proverbs 12:14. Proverbs 12:14. Again, it says, a man shall be satisfied with good. How is he going to be satisfied with good? By the fruit of his mouth. And it says, and the recompense of a man's hands shall be rendered unto him. You know, it's using a comparison there now. Man's going to be satisfied by good if he's doing good things. He's saying good things by the fruit of his mouth. And whatever the man's hands does, righteousness, it's going to be rendered righteous things back to him. See? See how simple it is, but it's still, see how rich and how deep this thing can go? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Another member of these bodies, the feet. The feet. Proverbs 1:16. Proverbs 1:16 says, for their feet run to evil and make haste to shed blood. What are their feet doing? They're running to evil. They're animated to do evil. These members are animated to do evil. So upon all that we heard, we can start breaking down now to the very core what's actually animating these feet to do evil and make haste to shed blood. Blood. It's talking about the wicked. Isaiah, concerning the feet. Isaiah 59. Kind of speeding this up a little bit. I'm trying to get all these members I got written down. And the verses, you know, down to y'all before I run out of time. I look like I got about 7 minutes or so. So I'm trying to rush fast real quick. Isaiah 59 and 7. Isaiah 59 and 7 says, their feet run to evil, and they make haste to shed innocent blood. Their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity. Wasting and destruction are in their path. Notice that. That, you know, the very core of their being that causes their feet to run to evil and how they make haste to shed innocent blood is because their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity. And because iniquity is in that body, iniquity will animate that body to do these things. And their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity, wasting, and destruction are in their paths. Their thoughts are thoughts of iniquity. Now I was thinking about that, and I heard Yeshua say, the love of many are waxing cold. Why? Because iniquity is abounding. And what is iniquity at the very core? Lawlessness. Law is nomos. The Greek word nomos. Iniquity is anomia. And every time in the Greek that you put the word a before another word, it negates or it cancels out what that word means. It completely opposites it. So, nomia is the law. Nomia is the law. Anomia is no law. Lawlessness. Romans 3:15. Hopefully I can get all this in before I run out of time here. I appreciate y'all here tonight, my family, my brothers and sisters. I just hope this has been a help to you, helping you know see a little bit farther, helping the eyes to see and the ears to hear, helping us in this war and in this fight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Romans 3:15. Their feet are swift to shed blood, destruction, or misery, and in their ways. and the way of peace have they not known. Again, in Proverbs 6:18, back in, you know, the hate, the things that the Most High hates, seven are an abomination unto him. Proverbs 6:18 says, a heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift in running to mischief. Notice that in Proverbs 6 there, and you know the thing, six things the Lord hates, the Most High hates, Yeshua hates, Yah hates, seven are abomination, and it deals with a lot of the things that are going on in the members. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So let me see how much time I got, saints. I'm looking at a clock. Oh, I got 2 minutes left. Oh, well. I don't think I can cover. I've got two more members I wanted to touch on, saints. And it was the heart and the eyes. And maybe another time, maybe I can pick up on that. I'll have to probably go over everything again lightly and then deal with the heart and the eyes. But since I've got about 2 minutes left, I'm going to go to the Apocrypha. And I'm going to think of Ecclesiasticus 9, I think it is. Let me see. Now I'm going to go to Wisdom of Solomon. That's what I'll go to. Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 9. I thought it was Ecclesiasticus. Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 9. Verses 14 and 15. Just want to leave some little food for thought upon everything else that has been brought forth tonight, this teaching. Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 9, 14 and 15, it says, for the thoughts of mortal men are miserable. And he don't want us to be mortal. He tells us there's going to be a time when this mortal shall put on immortality. This corruption shall put on incorruption. Sounds. Hallelujah. And that's what we're working through. That's what we're cleansing ourselves to the incorruption, to the immortal. Hallelujah. Because we're going to live. We're going to live eternally, saints. For the thoughts of mortal men, you got to understand that. Take it slow. Mortal men are miserable, and our devices are but uncertain. It says, for the corruptible body presses down the soul. What kind of body? The corruptible body. I'm talking about that body of sin. It presses down the soul. And the earthy tabernacle weigheth down the mind that museth upon many things. So understanding this war about, I pray and hope, saints, that tonight we got a little bit more insight what's going on in the spiritual warfare. Well, bless the Most High Yah for you, saints, tonight. Oh, it's still recording. My time is left out. Bless you, saints. Hope you can still hear me. Praise Yah. Have a blessed evening. I love you all. Shalom, shalom, shalom.
Uh-oh, look at him looking.